It is basically have two types. What is that? Uniform and non-uniform. Okay, so the basic difference is delta, right? So if delta is constant, we call it as a uniform. If it is not constant, we call it as a non-uniform. Okay, so next, what you have seen? So to realize non-uniform quantization, we go for what? Compressor followed by a uniform quantizer is nothing but non-uniform quantizer. Okay, right. So this is a compressor, right? Is a compressor. So what is the job of the compressor? It provides high gain to low signals, low gain to high signals. Now, so exactly opposite to the compressor, we have expander. It is something like this. Okay, so compressor plus expander combinedly called as what? Compander. Okay, so what else we have discussed? Right, so this is the overall effect of the compression and expansion. Obviously there is no effect. Okay, if you use both of them, there is no effect because they are exactly opposite to each other. Yeah, so this is the graph between input signal power versus SPNR in dBs. So if you use uniform quantizer, it is linear. If you use non-uniform quantizer, what is happening? So whether it is low signal or high signal, it is providing a constant SQNR. This is constant SQNR. Okay, SQNR is independent of the power of the signal, the power of the input signal. Whether you give low power signal or high power signal, doesn't matter. It always provides almost flat curve. Okay, but whereas in uniform quantizer, so for low signals, low SQNR, for high signals, high SQNR. That is not desirable. Okay, so that is the purpose of non-uniform quantizer. So what a purpose? So the SQNR is independent of input signal power. Okay, now so what you discuss, this is a uniform quantizer. Yeah, so this is how we use quantization. This is how we quantize. Okay, this is a table indicating all the related values. Always the error lies between plus or minus delta by 2. So there are two types of uniform quantizers, mid-rise, mid-rate. So you go through them once. Already I told you everything about these things. Yes, this is the error which is lie between plus or minus delta by 2. And this is how we find out the quantization noise power, which is delta square by 12. This is very, very important. Yeah, this is SQNR of a quantizer. So we have done the formula. This is a basic formula for any general signal. So particularly if you go for sinusoidal input, it would be equal to 1.8 + 6n in dBs. Okay, this statement is very, very important. Next, so the non-uniform quantization is based on the principle of progressive taxation. I told you what is this progressive taxation. What is that? So the amount of tax will be less for the poor people and it would be more for the rich people. We do so to overcome the economical disparities or differences. We employ same formula in case of non-uniform quantizer. Why? Same thing. We want to make SQNR independent of the input power. So to overcome this problems, we will go for non-uniform quantization, where we use less step size for low signals, more step size for high signals. Okay, and one more thing, so especially in case of voice signals, what is happening? The small amplitudes predominantly occurs. They occurs very frequently, whereas large amplitudes, they occur very less frequently. Okay, so these are the graphs, and these two combined called as non-uniform quantizer. Yeah, expander. This is the non-uniform quantizer. The most widely used compressors are ELA, MULA, and these are typical values of ELA, MULA for 8-bit quantizer. Yes. Now we go for pulse amplitude modulation, PAM. Pulse amplitude modulation. Okay. So already you know amplitude modulation. This already we know. What is that? Amplitude modulation means what? What happens? The amplitude of the carrier. Amplitude of the carrier changes according to the amplitude of the message signal. Correct? Amplitude of M of D. So here this is pulse amplitude modulation, which means so the amplitude of the pulse changes according to the amplitude of the message signal. Okay, so we have variety of pulse modulations like PAM, pulse amplitude modulation. Next we have pulse width modulation. Next we have pulse position modulation. Okay, but we discuss about only pulse amplitude modulation. So these remaining two are also very easy. Okay, so here pulse amplitude modulation means the amplitude of the pulse carrier changes according to the message signal. Okay, here so obviously one more thing, so they are known as discrete time modulations. They are known as discrete time modulations. Now so slowly we are entering into the digital modulations. Okay, so in analog modulations we have studied AM, PM, FM, so on. So now steadily we are entering into the digital domain. Okay, they are known as, these three are known as discrete time modulations. Okay, now here so the pulse amplitude modulation is defined like this. Okay, so this is a message signal M of T. Now here we use a rectangular pulses. This is similar to carrier. Okay, actually in AM what is the carrier? So in AM both are sinusoidal signals, M of T as well as C of T. This is M of T. What was C of T? C of T was a carrier. Again it was a some sinusoidal signal, something like this. This was the case in case of AM, but here we are using pulses. Okay, what happens now? So the amplitude of these pulses changes according to the this message signal M of T. Okay, how you can see very clearly. So here this is a message signal amplitude, so this is a pulse amplitude. Here message is increased, pulse also increased. Here decreasing, here also decreasing. So here it has gone to negative side, here also negative, here also negative peak, here is again negative, something like this, here again positive. Here so the amplitude of these pulses is changing or varying according to the amplitude of this message signal. So that's what's called pulse amplitude modulation. Okay, so obviously we have a pulse which is periodic in nature. This is a periodic signal. Okay, so what is the period? Ts, that is equal to 1/fs. Okay, so something like this. We have a pulse of duration t. Please understand this, we have pulse of duration t. So this is what we have here. This duration is Ts, sorry, this period is Ts, but what the width of the pulse, that is T. So the period of this pulses is Ts, that is equal to 1/fs, but the pulse width is T. Obviously Ts is much more than T. you can observe this here. Okay, so actually it is similar to flat tap sampling. It's nothing but flat tap sampling. You might have studied these things: natural sampling, flat tap sampling, sample and hold, all those things. Okay, why it is flat tap sampling? Because so the tops of the pulses are flat. Okay, so it is simply called as PAM. Yes, so obviously the amplitude of each and every pulse is what? So we are just sampling. It's nothing but sampling. So if you sample m of t, so what do you get? T equal to nts. So what do you get? M of nts. This is the amplitude of the pulse. So the amplitude of each and every pulse is m of nts. It depends upon the, what is the sample value here? Here, 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 here. So the sampled value will be the amplitude of the pulses. Okay. Yes. So ts is much, much more than t. It is called flat tap sampling. Yes. Okay. So what is the advantage of these pulse modulations? It can be anything. PAM, PWM, PPM. Okay. So let me briefly tell you what is PWM. Obviously, PWM means pulse width modulation. There, what happens here? So here amplitude of the pulse is changing. Their duration or width is same. Each and every pulse has same width, but it has got different amplitudes. In pulse width modulation, what will happen? Obviously, so they have the same amplitudes, but the pulses have different widths. Okay, suppose so amplitude is something like this. This is the width of the pulse. Next, so amplitude is increasing, width also increases. Next, so again decreasing, width may decrease. Something like this. This is a pulse width modulation. Now here the amplitudes are same. So this is same period TS, but what is changing? The widths are changing. They have different widths. What is the pulse position? The last one. What is the pulse position here? So they have a same amplitude, same width, but the position will be changing. What is the position means? So you take a starting point. Suppose this is starting point. So pulse will start from some other point. They change their positions. The positions will be proportional to the amplitude of the signal. So they have same amplitude and same width, but they change their positions according to the message signal. Okay, they deviate from their original positions. Okay, suppose this is their original position. Actually, they may be starting from here. Actually, they should start from here, but they are starting from some other point. There is a deviation of the starting point. There is a deviation in the position of the starting point of the pulse. So it is called pulse position modulation. Okay, so they are all pulse modulation, but so what is the common among all these things? Common is there is some free time. Time is freed up. Here there is a time gap. Okay, here in this time the channel is free, because nothing is being transmitted during these time intervals. So we exploit this advantage and we go for time division multiplexing. Okay, I have already explained frequency division multiplexing, but now I am explaining time division multiplexing. Okay, so what can I do is, so in this free time I can transmit some other signals. Because it is vacant, the channel is free, I can use this free time to transmit some other signals. Now this leads to the idea of time division multiplexing. Okay, we'll discuss elaborately about this later, but so this pulse modulations leads to the idea of TDM. Yeah, so these are the examples for PAM signals. Yeah, okay, so let us move on to the one more most famous pulse modulations, that is called pulse code modulation, simply known as PCM. PCM means pulse code modulation. Okay, now so till now we discussed PAM, PWM, PPM, and before that we have discussed analog modulations. Okay, now we discuss pulse modulations. In that, the primarily basically we should discuss about PCM. PCM stands for pulse code modulation. Now, so this is a transmitter of the PCM. This is a transmitter of the PCM. Okay, what it contains? The major blocks of PCM transmitter are a low pass filter, sampler, quantizer, encoder. Here I am using a uniform quantizer. Let us take like that. Now, actually, what is this? Can anybody tell me what these two are combinedly called as? Okay, what they're called as? The combination of sampling, quantization, encoding is known as what? What is that? You can message me. What is that? The combination of sampling, quantization, encoding is known as what? It is simply ADC, analog to digital converter, which means PCM transmitter is simply ADC, nothing more than that. Okay, so now, so the purpose of this low pass filter is, let us discuss the purpose of each and every block. So the purpose of this low pass filter is to eliminate the unwanted high frequency components. So obviously it removes all the high frequencies which are greater than or equal to greater than FM. This low pass filter removes components which are having a frequency more than FM. Okay, because they are unwanted for us, because we need a band limited signal. Okay, now that is the first block. Yes, so remaining blocks are sampler, quantizer, encoder. They are commonly called as simply ADC. So all those things we have already discussed. Okay, yeah, so all the operations are usually performed in a single circuit, that is called as ADC. Now, so this is a transmitter. Okay, here we get a PCM signal. PCM signal is nothing but a digital signal. Okay, what is a digital signal? Something like this, sequence of ones and zeros. I told you already. So this can be a digital signal, something like this. Okay, because the PCM transmitter is nothing but ADC. What is ADC? It converts analog signal to digital signal. Now this is a digital signal. Now, but obviously, so any communication system, we have three blocks: transmitter, and we have a channel, and we have a receiver. So transmitter is ADC. In case of PCM, so the transmitter is ADC. Obviously, what about receiver? General receiver should be opposite of transmitter. If it is ADC, it should be DAC. What is DAC? It is digital to analog converter. It should be DAC. Okay. Now here, so we have a channel here. Obviously, channel will add some noise. Okay, but so we have advantage in case of digital modulations. What is that? we can use something called regenerative repeaters. Okay, so in case of digital modulations, we can use regenerative repeaters, RR, along the transmission path or along the channel. So along the channel, you can use a chain of regenerative repeaters. What we do is, along the path, suppose we are transmitting from point A to point B. So we have a channel or a medium. What we do? We place regenerative repeaters sequentially at every 2 kilometers generally. Okay. Suppose this is a RR. It is another RR. It is another RR. RR means regenerative repeaters. Okay. So we are keeping a chain of regenerative repeaters along the transmission path at regular intervals, which means suppose at every 2 kilometers we can place a regenerative repeaters every 2 kilometers. So at every 2 kilometers we keep a regenerative repeaters. Okay, so what is the advantage of these regenerative repeaters? They will avoid the effect of noise. Okay, we keep regenerative repeaters very closely. At every 2 kilometers we keep a chain of regenerative repeaters. So the advantage of RRC is it doesn't allow noise to get accumulate. What it will do? It doesn't allow noise to get accumulate. Okay, so how it is possible? What is happening here? So from PCM we are getting a digital signal, so that will be transmitted via channel. In the channel, noise will be added. Okay, now so to the RR, what is input? A distorted PCM signal. But what RR will do? It will give you a clean and noise free PCM signal. So what exactly happens is, so let me take a simple example here. Okay, so this is a digital signal or PCM signal. Okay, this is a PCM signal. It is something like this. This is a PCM signal we have generated. Okay, so we are transmitting over a channel. We are transmitting via a channel or a medium. So because of channel noise, it will be distorted. Suppose after some distance, you may get a distorted version of PCM signal, something like this. What is this? It is distorted because of channel noise. Now, so since it's a digital signal, we can apply this to the what? Regenerative repeater. What it will do? It will remove the noise and it will produce clean and noise free PCM signal. What it will do is it will regenerate the pulses. So from this distorted signal, it will produce clean pulses, something like this. Okay, so again we transmit this clean pulse. Again after some 2 kilometers, we have another RR. Let us take RR2. So it will be again distorted because we are transmitting over a channel. It will be again distorted after some distance. Again this second repeater will remove the distortions or noise. So we do like this. We keep a chain of repeaters along the path which are very closely spaced. Approximately at every 2 kilometers we place some repeater, so they will remove the noise. So the repeater will provide a clean and noise free PCM signal. So like this, this RRs doesn't allow noise to get accumulate. They don't allow noise to accumulate. They're repeating time to time. They're removing time to time. Okay. So That is advantage of digital communications. Okay. Obviously, this is a receiver. What is a receiver? So this is a decoder, reconstruction filter, destination. This is digital to analog converter. Obviously, very simple thing. Okay. Finally, you get a your analog signal. Correct. This is a PCM. Yeah. So this is analog signal. This is a PCM signal. Simply, it is simply ADC, analog to digital converter. So what is digital signal? It is signal which is sequence of ones and zeros. Okay. Now, so here, so if I write simply, what is PCM? The transmitter is ADC. We have a channel. And the receiver is opposite of transmitter, that is due to a converter. So, but the advantage of this modulation technique is we can keep a chain of regenerative repeaters, RRs, along the transmission path. Okay. What the purpose of these RRs? They remove the noise effectively. So in PCM, the effect of noise will be minimized because of this regenerative repeaters. Okay. So the transmitter receivers are very, very simple. Okay. But so here there is a simple question. What is that? Is PCM is not a modulation in the conventional sense. Why? Because so till now we have seen modulation means we should have two parameters. What is that? Message signal and carrier. You take any modulation, we should have a message and carrier. But in PCM, there is no carrier. Nowhere we are saying carrier, right? Where is the carrier? You look at the transmitter and receiver. They are just ADC and DAC. There is no carrier at all. But still we are calling it as a modulation. So conventionally, we should never say it is a modulation actually. But why we are calling it as a modulation? Because in the modulation, one of the characteristics of the carrier is varied in proportion with the amplitude of the modulated signal. So nothing sort of that happens in PCM. Okay. So we should not say it's a modulation in conventional sense, but we generally call it the modulation because the only reason is what we do here is, so we are have a sampler, right? In the transmitter part, we have a sampler. Where is that sampler? Yes. The sampler. We have sampler, right? But in sampler, how to sample a signal? You take any sampling, whether it is a ideal or whether it is a natural or flat tap. Generally, what we do? We take message signal, M of T, we multiply with a train of impulses. Impulses or rectangle pulses. So, yeah, you can simply assume that this is message signal, this is carrier. Okay, we are getting a sampled signal. This happens in sampling process. So in that sense, this is acting as a carrier. Okay, that's why we can call it as a pulse code modulation. But conventionally, there is no carrier. It is not a modulation actually. But in the sampling process, we are multiplying messages with some train of impulses, which will act as carrier. In that sense, it is a modulation. Otherwise, it is not a modulation technique. Okay. Now, yeah. So I have solved some examples. You just go through them. One more thing is SQNR of PCM. Here, already we have discussed SQNR, right? So what are the formulas we discuss for quantizer? Okay, what do you discuss? We have discussed the quantization error, that is always between plus or minus delta by 2. Quantization noise power, how much is this? Delta square by 12. And what is SQNR for sinusoidal input signal? dBs. SQNR for sinusoidal input signal dBs is approximately 1.8 plus 6N. So all are valid for PCM. All the calculations that we have done for quantizer are valid for PCM also. In PCM also, there will be SQNR. The formula is same because in PCM we use quantizer. That's why all the calculations that we have done for quantizer are applicable to PCM also. They may simply call find the SQNR of PCM. Don't get confused. All the formulas that we discuss about quantizer are true for PCM also, because in PCM also there is a quantizer, the transmitter part. Okay. So you solve these things. I have solved some of the problems. You go through them once. Yeah. So this is one of the examples where this is the message signal. This is a quantized signal. Message means we have taken samples and we have quantized. You get something like this. Okay. And this is the error. What is that? The quantization error. I shown this already. Okay. And this is a decoded signal. And this is a reconstructed signal. Okay. So this is one more example. You go through them, all these things here, using mid rate. This is using mid rise. Okay. So I have done PCM signal using uniform quantizer. That is also two types, mid rate and mid rise. Okay. So now, so that is about PCM. Now next, what happens here is we go for another technique that is called differential PCM, simply called as DPCM. Now, so what happens here is you take naturally occurring signals such as audio and video have high correlation. Okay, what I'm asking is, so we have discussed PCM. Okay, now we'll discuss DPCM. What a DPCM means? Differential PCM. Differential PCM, simply called as DPCM. Okay. So what they are saying is, naturally occurring signals such as audio, video have high correlation. Okay. Generally, so if you take audio, video, we sample with more rate, more sampling rate. Now, if you do so, these are the samples. This is a signal and these are the samples. Now the observation here is the samples are not independent. They're highly correlated or they're highly similar. Okay. You observe these two samples. They're exactly same. They're highly similar. They are highly correlated. Okay. So you take these samples, they're not independent of each other. They have correlation between them, or they have a more similarity between them. Okay. So this happens if you sample with more rate. Okay. So it's observed that, so signals like audio, video, if you sample with high sampling rate, they have high correlation. The samples have high correlation. They have high amount of similarity. Okay. So when it happens, it leads to redundancy. What is redundancy? Transmitting unwanted signals. Okay. Why? Because see, suppose you just take this. These two are very, very close to each other. These first two samples. So if you are transmitting them, what do you mean by that? Obviously, you're transmitting two same signals, two same samples. Okay. If you transmit these two samples, it is nothing but as if you are transmitting two same signals at a time. So that is called redundancy. Okay. So at the output side, you receive two same samples. Okay. So the question is, why do you transmit two same signals? Okay. One is redundant. That is not necessary for transmission. Okay, if something is similar, what do you transmit again and again? We are wasting our power and bandwidth. Okay, so that is called redundancy. Redundancy means unwanted information that is being transmitted repeatedly. Okay, since the samples have high amount of correlation, so obviously it is the receiver, we may think that so same information is being transmitted repeatedly. Okay, so it may lead to high amount of redundancy. What is that? Redundancy. Transmitting unwanted information repeatedly. Okay, so in this case, it may lead to redundancy. Now, so to avoid this problem, what we go is we go for DPCM, differential PCM. Obviously, the name itself indicates the transmitting difference. Okay, what difference? Okay, so you observe this. Samples, they are highly correlated and they are not independent of each other, obviously. Now the idea is, so in PCM, suppose you take these two samples, some samples, okay, something like this. In PCM we used to transmit all the samples. Suppose this is the first sample, second, third, okay, this is the third sample, the fourth is a fifth sample. We have five samples, so we should take samples and we used to quantize them and encode them, and we used to transmit. So we used to transmit five samples. Okay, but here, so in DPCM the idea is we don't transmit samples. What we transmit, we transmit the difference between the samples. Okay, since the samples are very much similar, it is a good idea, a clever idea, to transmit the difference between them rather than transmitting the samples directly. Okay, now, so instead of transmitting samples, what I transmit is, I transmit the difference between them. Difference between two consecutive samples. Okay, I will transmit this difference. Okay, I don't transmit the sample values. I will transmit the difference between the successive samples. Okay, so obviously, what happens if you transmit this difference? That would be very, very small, because they are not independent, they are highly correlated. So by transmitting the small value, we can save so much power. Okay, so if you transmit the sample, you transmit this much value, but if you transmit the difference between the samples, you just transmit this value, this difference, which is very, very small. That is called error. Okay, now the best idea is, so it is further improvised. What they're doing is, so we have a samples, right? Let me take some samples. Okay, this is a fifth sample. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What we do here is, so instead of transmitting the difference between two successive samples, the best idea is transmit difference between a sample and its prediction. So transmit the difference between a sample and its prediction. So this is even a clever idea. What is that? What we do here is, we predict the sample value. Suppose, so how prediction happens generally? Weather prediction. How they predict? They predict based on the past data or previous data. Weather prediction, everything is predicted based on the past values or previous data. Okay, we do same thing here. Here, so let us take the fifth sample. Okay, now we predict the fifth sample from the previous four samples. Okay, so we have predictors for that. Okay, we have a predictor which predicts fifth samples using previous four samples. Okay, now we have two things. What is that? The prediction, we have two things. What are they? A fifth sample original value. This is original. And we have a predicted value. Phi cap means predicted value or estimated value. Estimated or predicted. Okay, now what we do? Now we quantize this difference between original value and its prediction. But how to predict? It is based on the previous samples. Okay, now so the idea is generally, so in PCM we take x of t, we sample it with a rate or with interval ts, we get a x of nts. Okay, we get x of nts, correct? X of nts. But so I am writing x of n for simplicity. I am not writing this ts. Okay, x of n. Okay, PCM. What we used to do is, so we are transmitting all the samples of this x of n one by one. Okay, now so in DPCM, what we transmit is, we transmit difference between a sampled value, means original value, minus its prediction. What is x cap of n? It is a prediction of, or you can call estimation. Prediction of x of n. Every sample is predicted. Okay, and we have take the difference, and this will be actually quantized, encoded, and transmitted. That is the idea of DPCM. But so it is still modified. It is not the original case now. It is need to be modified a little bit. Now the basic idea is in DPCM we take the difference between original value and its predicted value, and that difference or that error will be transmitted. Okay, now so before that, so let us go for a predictor. This is a predictor of order p. It is called linear predictor. Okay, so it is using some delay elements and some multiplier coefficients, W1, W2, so on, so on, WP. Okay, so it's a predictor. So input is x of n, output is x hat of n or x cap of n. It's a prediction. Okay, from this, what is x cap of n? Can you write down what happens now? It is unit delay. If it is x of n, it is x of n minus 1. Again, unit delay. X of n minus 2, so on, x of n minus p. It is a pth order. Why order is p? Because it is using p delay elements. P delay elements and p multipliers or prediction coefficients. They are also called as prediction coefficients or multiplier coefficients. Okay. What is x of n? What is x cap of n? That is W1 x of n plus W2 x of n minus 1, correct? Isn't it? So this is what happens here. What is this output? I made a mistake. This is W1 x of n minus 1. plus W2 x of n minus 2. Okay, plus what is this? So on, so on. Plus so on, so on. What the last one? Wp x of n minus p. Okay. Now in this equation, this is estimated using previous values. What are previous values? First value, second previous value, pth previous value. It is taking p previous values or previous samples to estimate or to predict the present sample. Okay, and so we need to provide the proper coefficients. They are also very, very important. Okay, so our aim is to make proper estimation or proper prediction. Proper means what? It should be exactly same as the original signal. If it is so, we say that we had a proper prediction or accurate prediction. So when you say prediction is accurate, so if there's something, if it happens, that is an accurate prediction for estimation. Same thing happens here. So if your original value same as your predicted value, your prediction is accurate. Okay, but for that purpose, you need to take proper past samples and proper values of these coefficients. So how to find these coefficients is out of the scope of the syllabus, but so we need to select proper values of these multiplier coefficients also. Okay, now yeah, so this is the linear predictor. Why linear? Because it's adding everything linearly. So one more thing, what a first order predictor. First order means there is only one deal elements, these are all removed, only one is there, means x of n minus 1. So the first order predictor is x cap of n equal to x of n minus 1, which means, so the previous input, what is x of n minus 1? Previous input. Okay, so the first order predictor is nothing but previous input. What do you mean by this? What do you mean by this? So we are saying, suppose we are estimating, so if you use only first order predictor, what are you saying is the present value is same as previous value. You are simply saying, you are simply estimating, saying that so present will be same as previous value. That is the simplest way of prediction. So that is called first order prediction. Generally we do this. Okay, but so if you want more accurate data, you take more order, you take pth order, which means you are using p multipliers, p unit deal elements. Obviously p unit deal elements means p previous samples. Okay, so understand very carefully. Here we are taking p number of past data or past samples. Okay, so that is a predictor. We have predictors, well predictors. Okay, so let us come to the DPCM. In DPCM we use predictors, that is the idea, right? Now so let us go to the DPCM transmitter. This is a DPCM transmitter. So there is a little bit of modifications are there. Okay, now what are those modifications? So what is being quantized? E of n. What is input to the quantizer? E of n. What is E of n? It is a difference between original sample minus this one. Okay, so what is that? So looking at the transmitter of DPCM, so input to the quantizer is E of n, output is EQ of n. Okay, and we have predictor. Input to the predictor is XQ of n, output of the predictor is obviously XQ of n cap. Okay, so now, so let us define everything. X of n, what is X of n? That is a sampled value. Here I am not writing TS, I told you already, I am omitting TS, that's it. Okay, right, Next, x q of n cap, it is a predictor output. Predictor, its output is x q of n cap. Next, so I am introducing the terminologies first of all. What is e of n? Obviously, from this diagram, e of n is difference between this and this. That is called error or difference. E of n, quantizer input. EQ of n, quantizer output. Okay, so to the quantizer, input is E of n, output is EQ of n. What is error? EQ of n minus E of n. That is called Q of n. What is Q of n? Quantization error. Or quantization error, that is Q of n, that equal to output quantized value minus input value, E of n. Now, so let us write the some of the equations looking at the transmitter of the DPCM. What we write? Okay, here, so from this diagram, what is E of n? Okay, tell me, what is E of n? E of n equal to, it is called error or difference, x of n minus xq of n cap. Okay, that is E of n. What is input to the quantizer? E of n. Output is EQ of n. Obviously, because of quantization, we get some error. That is called quantization error. That is Q of n. That equal to EQ of n minus E of n. Here, be careful, please. Next. What is XQ of n? That is input to the predictor. We have summation here. What is XQ of n equal to? EQ of n plus XQ of n cap. This plus this. What is this? XQ of n cap. What is this? EQ of n. So XQ of n equal to, please be careful here. EQ of n plus XQ of n cap. So from this first equation, the second equation, this third equation. So from the first equation, what is xq of n cap? What is this? That is x of n minus e of n. Okay, okay, from first xq of n cap equal to x of n minus, what is that? E of n. Is it okay? Now, so substitute xq of n in the here. Substitute xq of n cap this here. Okay, then, okay. So then, what is xq of n now? That equal to EQ of n plus X of n minus E of n. Okay. So be careful here. XQ of n equal to EQ of n plus X of n minus E of n. So you can write further, x of n plus eq of n minus e of n. Here, what is this? Eq of n minus e of n. Eq of n minus e of n. That is q of n. So finally, xq of n equal to x of n plus q of n. What is Q of n? Quantization error corresponding to the error signal. Okay. Now, so what happens here? Okay, simple. In DPCM, so we take the error, that is difference between a sample signal and its estimation. and we quantize the error or difference, and we transmit this signal to the channel. What we transmit? We are transmitting the quantized version of error or difference. I told you already, we transmit the difference, not the original samples. Okay, this will be transmitted through the channel. Okay, so this is the transmitter part, correct? Now, so here, now, so let us go to the receiver part. Okay, so this is a receiver. This is a receiver of the TPCM. Okay, so in receiver also we use same predictor. Okay, if you observe very carefully, what is the receiver? It is this portion. So where is the receiver? So you observe this portion of the transmitter. So this portion. This box is nothing but receiver. Okay, so you can see very clearly here. Okay, so your decoder and same predictor. Why same predictor? What is input of the predictor? XQFN. What is the output of the predictor? Is XQFN cap. Okay. So here also, what is XQFN? That is nothing but EQFN plus XQFN cap. EQFN plus XQFN cap. Okay, obviously, what is XQFN? Then now we discuss what is q of n, x of n plus q of n. So the output of the receiver is x q of n. Observe very carefully. But x q of n equal to x of n plus q of n. It is very, very important. This is the idea actually. At the output of the receiver, we are getting the original samples. What are x of n's? Original samples plus some quantization error. Obviously, we get some error, but this q of n is an error, quantization error of what signal? It is not related to x of n. Please understand this. It is not depends upon x of n. It is an error of what signal? It corresponds to e of n. Different signal. This is very, very important. Okay? In PCM, generally how to find error? Quantization error. Sampled value, sorry, quantized value means sampled value. Okay? But here, this quantization error depends upon the different signal. Where is that? This signal. Not this signal. Because we are not quantizing x of n, but we are quantizing e of n. Okay? So, now, yeah, we are able to get desired signal x of n plus some noise q of n. Here the quantization noise is associated with the error signal e of n. Now it provides improvement in SQNR. Okay, how much improvement do you get over PCM? That you have to find out. That is homework to you. Okay, you find out how much improvement in SQNR is possible in DPCM compared to the PCM. You find out that. Okay, now this is about DPCM. differential pulse code modulation, where a different signal is being quantized and transmitted instead of the original samples. We are doing so to get better SQNR. Okay, but how much improvement will you get? That you have to find out. Okay, so I explained everything very neatly. I hope so. So we try to find out the improvement in SQNR. Okay. So thank you. We stop here. You can leave.